Hello friends, today's topic is previous year and assessment year. So it is in continuation with the basic concepts, topic number one that we are covering. Under basic concept, previous year and assessment year, we will be covering what is previous year, what is the definition of previous year, what is the definition of assessment year, and how the income is assessed to tax, subject to tax in the assessment year, and what are the various exceptions to it. So previous year and assessment year. So this is a regular concept that you will come across under the income tax law. So there is currently, if you ask, there is a financial year. Income is assessed to tax as per the financial year. Financial year runs from April 1 to March 31. Financial year and previous year are synonymous. Income which is earned in the previous year or in the relevant financial year is assessed to tax in the assessment year in the subsequent assessment year. Meaning, financial year in our case currently is 2019-20. And the assessment year would be immediately preceding, which will start from April 2020, which will go on to March 2021. So the previous year and assessment are together. Its only thing is the income of the assessee in the previous year is assessed to tax in the assessment year. On the screen, income earned in previous year is assessed to tax in the assessment year, which is immediately succeeding to the previous year. Previous year for the business or profession which is newly set up, their previous year would be the date on which the business and profession starts, for example 1st of July 2019, and it will go on to 31st March 2020. Vis-a-vis, generally, if it would have been a continuing business, then it would have start on 1st of April 2019 and it would be same as 31st March 2020. Then previous year for undisclosed sources of income. So we were talking about certain exceptions. So generally, previous year income is assessed to tax in the assessment year. But in the following cases, the income will be taxed in the previous year in which the undisclosed sources of income is assessed, is determined, or comes into picture. So the first is cash credits. So any credit in the books of accounts of the assessee, any cash credit which is visible in the books of accounts of the assessee, for which the assessee is not able to provide any explanation, or the explanation provided by the assessee is not satisfactory as per the assessing officer, in that case the income will be charged as a deemed income, and it will be charged at the rate of tax applicable as per section 115BBEE. So meaning, any cash credit for which there is no explanation provided by the assessee or explanation is not satisfactory, it will be taxable as the deemed income in the year in which the cash credit comes into picture. On the screen, cash credits, any sum found credited in the books of accounts for which no explanation is offered or explanation offered is not satisfactory, sum so credited will be deemed as income of that previous year. Now, closely held companies who has received the share application money or share capital or share premium shall be deemed to be not satisfactory unless the person in whose name the amount is credited offers explanation on the source of funds. Meaning, the closely held company, if in the books of accounts any share application money or share premium is found, then the assessing officer won't wait for the explanation provided by the assessee, and it will be straightforward taxable as a deemed income. The only exception being the person in whose name the funds, the source of funds are there. For example, in the books of accounts, the funds has been received from XYZ. So the XYZ person, if he provides an explanation to the source of funds, then it may not be taxable as deemed income in the hands of closely held company. So the closely held company, if there is any share application money or share capital or share premium, it is reflecting in the books of accounts, it will be deemed as income in the hands of closely held company unless and until the XYZ person states the source of funds. Then, next criteria, further such deeming provision is not applicable if such person, in an example XYZ, in whose name the sum is recorded in the books of accounts, is a venture capital fund or venture capital company. Next is unexplained investments. So, if there is any unexplained investments which is not disclosed in the books of accounts and for which no explanation is offered by the SSC or the explanation offered by the SSC is not satisfactory as per the assessing officer, then such investment will be deemed as income in the hands of SSC. Similar for unexplained money. Unexplained money is nothing but money, bullion, jewelry, and valuable article which has been purchased but it has not been disclosed in the books of accounts of the SSC and there is no satisfactory explanation provided by the SSC. So in that case, the unexplained money, that is the bullion, jewelry, money or valuable article, would be deemed as income in the hands of the SSC. Next is amount of investment which are not fully disclosed. So unexplained money and unexplained investment when not disclosed in the books of accounts, if they are disclosed in the books of accounts but are partly disclosed, then the part which is not disclosed in the books of account would be termed as deemed income as per section 69B. Unexplained investment, unexplained expenditure is the next part which has been defined, which has been covered under section 69C. See, in that case, there is an expenditure incurred by the SSC, but the only thing is, he offers no explanation for the expenditure or explanation offered is not satisfactory. In that case, that particular expenditure would be deemed as income in the hands of the SSC. Next is amount borrowed or repaid on hundi. So, which has been covered under section 69D. So, what is hundi? Hundi is a financial instrument reflecting trade and credit transactions. So, in this case, amount is borrowed for the trade purpose by the SSC and he needs to repay the amount along with the principal amount and interest. So, in that case, if the amount is paid by other than account pay check, then the amount which has been borrowed or which has been repaid would be deemed as income in the hands of the SSC. On the screen, hundi is a financial instrument reflecting trade and credit transactions. If the amount borrowed or repaid is other than account pay check, then borrowed amount or repaid amount will be deemed as income in the hands of SSC. Next section is section 115 BBE. Whenever the income is taxable as deemed income in the aforesaid section, in the aforesaid sections which we have discussed, that will be taxable as per section 115 BBE at the rate of 60%. So this is a maximum rate which is applicable based on the circumstances of the case, in which case you can say that SSC is in a way penalized and the tax rate is at a higher rate at 60% in their cases. So coming on to the illustration, Mr. A borrowed on hundi a sum of 45,000 by way of a bearer check on 1st of September 2019. So it's other than account pay check, and repaid the sum with interest by account pay check. So in this case, the amount is borrowed other than account pay check and it has been repaid correctly as per an account pay check. So the assessing officer wants to treat the amount borrowed as income during the previous year. Is the action of AO valid? So as per the terms that we have read earlier, if hundi is borrowed or repaid other than account pay check, it will be treated as a deemed income and taxable at the rate of 60% as per section 115 BBE. So in this case, the action of the AO, we can say, is valid and the SSC will be taxable on the borrowed income at the rate of 60%. Next illustration on the screen. During the course of assessment of a firm, AO found that it had paid rent in respect of its business premises amounting to 80,000, which was not debited in the books of accounts. So there is an expenditure which is not disclosed in the books of accounts. For the year ending 2020, March 2020, the firm did not explain the source of payment of rent. So the amount is not disclosed and there is no explanation provided by the SSC. The assessing officer proposes to make an addition of 18,000 in the hands of the firm for the assessment year 2021. So assessing officer has added the amount as 80,000 in the hands of the firm. The firm claims that even if the addition is made, the sum of 80,000 should be allowed as deduction while computing its business income, since it has expended for the purpose of its business. Explain the claim of the firm. So in this case, you can say it's an example of unexplained expenditure. So unexplained expenditure, the condition was amount is not disclosed in the books of accounts. No explanation is offered by the SSC, or explanation offered by the SSC is not satisfactory. If these conditions get satisfied, then the expenditure which has been expended would be termed as deemed income. So as per the para 1, it's like unexplained expenditure conditions are satisfying and it would be termed as deemed income under section 115 BBE. And it would be taxed at the rate of 60%. And now the claim of the firm, it's like whether the expenditure would be allowed as an expended, since it has been expended, the expenditure should be allowed. As per the claim of the firm, the thing is, we do not know the source of the funds in this case. Since the source of the funds are not known, it could be a possibility that, you know, certain income received in cash has been used for the purpose of expenditure and now they're trying to claim an expenditure of the same. So the claim of the firm is not tenable, and in this case the unexplained expenditure will be continued to be a deemed income under section 115 BBE and it will be taxed at the rate of 60%. Moving on to the next topic, which is in which case, you know, the income will be taxed in the previous year itself in certain cases. First is shipping business of non-resident. So a non-resident who has a ship, and ship is used for transit of passengers or livestock or goods, and it has come, entered the territorial waters of India, entered the port of India, and is going outside India. Now the ship, when it's moving outside India, won't be allowed to go outside India, because the only thing would be, as per this section, what this section says, in such cases where the ship has entered territorial waters of India, transit passengers and livestock has been transported to India, and thereafter it is moving outside India, it will be like the applicable taxes should be paid in India. Only thereafter it will be allowed to move outside India. In this case, 7.5% of the freight which is received by the ship in India would be termed as a deemed income in their hands, in the hands of the non-resident, and it will be subject to tax in India in the previous year itself. On the screen, ship is coming to India and going back. Ship is carrying passengers, livestock and goods. Ship is not allowed to move outside India unless taxes are paid or satisfactory arrangements are made in this regard. 7.5% of the freight to be received is deemed to be income in the previous year. Next is person leaving India. Person leaving India, if the assessing officer is of the view that person is about to leave India and has no arrangement or has no intention to come back to India, then any income received for the period from 1st of April to the period from the date of leaving, for example, he is leaving on 31st of July, then the income from 1st of April to 31st July in the previous year will be assessed to tax in that previous year itself. On the screen, where it appears to here that person is living outside India with no intention of returning to India, date of April 1st to date of departure is subject to tax in that previous year itself. Next is AOP, BOI, AJP, artificial judicial person, formed for a particular event or purpose. So in this case, once the event or purpose here comes to the conclusion that once the purpose is over and the AOP POI is dissolved, then the income from the date of 1st of April to the date of dissolution will be subject to tax in that previous year itself. On the screen, if assessing officer is of the view that AOP BOI AJP is likely to be dissolved in the same year or in the next year, he may make the assessment of the income up to the date of dissolution. And the fourth point is person likely to transfer property to avoid tax as per section 175. In that case, the period would be from 1st of April to the period when the assessing officer commences proceedings under this section. The same period would be chargeable to tax in that particular previous year only. And the last point is discontinued business. In case of discontinued business, the assessment year would be from the 1st of April to the date of discontinuance. That period will be charged to tax in that particular year itself. So to summarize, in this topic, we have read the concept of previous year and assessment year, the way exceptions to the assessment of the income in that particular year. So first would be previous year for the undisclosed sources of income. In that we have studied cash credits, unexplained investments, unexplained money, amount of investments which is not fully disclosed, unexplained expenditure, amount borrowed or repaid in hundi, and section 115 BBE. There were several illustrations on the concept. Then the income which is taxed under the previous year itself for certain heads of income. So first was shipping business of a non-resident person living outside India. AOP BOI formed for a particular event of persons in person event or purpose. In case of dissolution of the same, it can be charged to tax in that previous year itself. Person likely to transfer property to avoid tax and dissolution business. Thank you.